Unity's input API has been pretty much the same for as long as I could remember. And while it does a great job of handling player input, it could use a lot of improvement in some areas. One of those areas is configuration. In this video, we're going to learn about a feature of Unity's new input system called Input Action Assets, and how it makes the pain associated with configuring controls a thing of the past. Let's get right into it. Throughout this tutorial, we'll be iterating on a very simple project that has nothing more than a controllable player character and a simple environment. The player character's movement is driven by the player script, which exposes an input action field called movement. Input actions abstract the details of actual controls, so input can be configured and handled in a more generic way. If we take a quick look at the player script in the code editor, we can see that input is processed using a set of events: performed and canceled. These events can be raised by any number of different controller types. For this example, I've configured movement to be controlled by two different groups of keyboard keys: W, A, S, and D, and I, K, J, and L. Input actions are great for configuring your game's input, but managing them directly on the player script is going to start to become a pain if we keep adding controllers. And I definitely want to add more controllers. So instead, we're going to move our key bindings to an input action asset. That way, they'll be much easier to maintain, and we can even reuse them in other projects. Speaking of projects, you can download the example project for this tutorial using the link in the description and follow along with me. Why don't you do that now? Pause the video, set up your environment, and we'll get started. Right-click anywhere within your project asset folder. Then hover over Create and click Input Actions. You can name the asset whatever you'd like. I'm going to call mine Player Controls. Now, double-click the asset to open up the Input Actions Editor window. I'm going to dock mine next to the scene view, but you should move yours wherever is most comfortable for you. Perfect. Now, let's recreate the same input actions that we applied to the player script. Start off by creating an action map by clicking the plus sign inside of the action map's header bar. Action maps act as a way to logically group input actions. Our example is really simple, so I'll just give it a generic name like gameplay. But other, more complicated games like Red Dead Redemption 2 might have multiple action maps for different scenarios, like combat, riding a horse, or crafting. Now we can begin to add our bindings. Click on the plus sign inside of the action's header. Let's name it movement, just like the input action field in the player script. And delete the empty binding that was auto-generated by right-clicking it and selecting delete. We need to use a composite for this input action, so click on the plus sign and select Create 2D Vector Composite. There. That should look familiar, right? Fill in the binding path for the up, down, left, and right properties with the W, A, S, and D keys. If you'll recall from the previous video, the binding path is essentially the physical control that's responsible for raising input-related events. Alright, now let's bind the I, K, J, and L keys. Our player script listened to the pressed and canceled events raised by the keys that we bound to the movement input actions. But as you'll see soon, we're going to respond to input events in a slightly different way using the input action asset. Great. Now that all of our controls are bound, let's put this input action asset to work. But first, there's something very important that we need to do. And you can't forget it. Do not forget to click Save Asset. Or, better yet, just save yourself the headache and enable autosave. Much better. Crisis averted. Now, go ahead and open the player script in your code editor. We're going to need to expose a field for our new player controls asset so we can begin working with it. Create a private serialized input action asset field. I'm going to call mine player controls. And for the sake of readability, I'm just going to add a space attribute that I'll get rid of later. Now, we can use this reference to gain access to the movement input action that we defined under the gameplay action map. In the awake method, create a local variable called gameplay action map and initialize it by calling getActionMap on player controls and passing in the string gameplay. Then initialize the existing movement field by calling getActionOnGameplayActionMap and passing in the string movement. As you may have guessed, gameplay and movement are the names that we defined in our input action asset. So if you use different ones, then adjust your method calls accordingly. Alright, the last thing we need to do is hide the movement field from the editor, since we're explicitly setting it inside of the wake method. All we need to do is remove the serialized field attribute. Great. Now we can run our quick test to make sure that everything works. Switch on over to Unity. First, populate the new player controls field with our custom input action asset. Then, press play and move around. Beautiful. We've made the first step to utilizing input action assets, but there are some things that we can definitely improve on. Let's pop back into the code editor. Being able to access action maps and their bindings using strings is great for dynamic behavior, but it's also very much prone to error. So I'm going to replace these string accessors with a strongly typed solution. Now, normally, the first thing I'd do is encapsulate this logic in a couple of methods, and then break them off into their own class. But luckily, I don't have to do either of those things, because Unity will do it for me. Switch back to Unity, and I'll show you what I mean. You may have noticed already that when you select an input action asset, the inspector gives you the option to generate a C# class. The class it generates is an encapsulation of the input action asset, complete with strongly typed accessors for all of your custom action maps and input actions. Let's generate one now for player controls by enabling the Generate C# Class checkbox. Now, there are a few options here that should be pretty self-explanatory. You can define where the class file is saved, what the class should be named, which namespace it should live in, and whether or not interfaces and events should be generated. For this example, I'm going to make sure that the class file is saved to my scripts folder. I'll leave the name and namespace fields blank so the default values are used, and I'm going to have the tool generate an interface for my action map. More on that later. Press Apply. And there's my Player Controls class. Let's open it in the code editor. Let's take a quick look at the initialize method. Do these two lines look familiar? They use the exact same calls that we made earlier in the player class. The Player Controls class exposes these values on a couple of public properties that we can now utilize in our scripts. So let's open up the player class again and change the type of the player controls field from input action asset to our brand new player controls class. Now, instead of calling get action map, we can use the gameplay property directly. And instead of calling get action, we can use the movement property. While we're at it, why not make this a one-liner? Now this is much better. As usual, we've made a change, so let's switch back to Unity and make sure that everything still works. Before we run the scene, we need to reset the value of the player controls field. Now, its type is player controls, but the class that we generated earlier has a custom property drawer that accepts an input action asset. So we're going to set the field using the player controls asset. Alright, press play, and test out your controls. Beautiful. Now this is all fine and well. The code works, and it's much more robust. But there's actually a completely different approach that we could take that has to do with the interface that we generated earlier. Open up the Player Controls class in your code editor, and scroll down to the iGameplayActions interface. Just like the two properties that we used in the player class, this interface is named based on the action map that we defined in our input action asset. And likewise, the method onMovement is named after the input action that we added under gameplay. If we scroll up to the gameplay action struct, which is the type used for the gameplay property, we can see that there's a method called setCallbacks that accepts an instance of iGameplayActions. In a nutshell, This method registers the instance of iGameplayActions to the movement input actions events, started, performed, and canceled. This will serve as the basis for our next change. Switch back to the player class and have it implement the iGameplayActions interface. Then implement the onMovement method. This will be the new home for player's movement logic, so copy and paste in the contents of the onMovementChanged method. Now we can use this class as the callback instance for the gameplay action map. In Awake, call setCallbacks on playerControl's gameplay property and pass in the this operator. SetCallbacks will now register the player class's onMovement method for movements started, performed, and canceled events, which means we don't have to anymore. So, let's remove all of our previous logic surrounding movement, including the property itself. And instead of enabling and disabling movement, we'll need to enable and disable the player controls directly. There. Let's test it out. Switch back to Unity, run the scene, and move around. Beautiful. And that's all there is to it. Input actions are flexible, shareable, and easy to maintain, and they make managing your key bindings a breeze. Plus, they have a couple of other great features that I'll be covering in my next input tutorial. If you don't want to miss it, make sure you subscribe and hit the bell icon so you'll be notified as soon as it comes out. If you enjoyed this video, then please leave a like and a comment letting me know what you thought. And as always, thanks for watching, and I'll catch you in the next video. Thank you to all of my patrons, and a special shout out to Dark Rush Photography, Yakov, Will and Dingo, Thomas, Sean Carey, Richard Stance, and NZ.